Not till I know you better. Make it one for my baby. And one more. But like anyone comes in a bar to hear grief from the pianist, you no doubt have enough of your own. Still, today is a kind of anniversary, so I'm not making any promises. Well, that's how it goes. Cheer. I hope that in my mind bending your ear. But this torch that I found, okay, enough. I'm just down, not suicidal. I'll be right as rain by tomorrow, my usual cheery self. Okay, well, what else? A tune for her? Why not? Something she liked? What? Mrs. Foster Jenkins didn't care for cheap music, and I doubt you want to hear Mozart. She liked this. Well, she pretended she didn't. Crazy rhythm, here's a dope. I'll go my way, you'll go your way. Crazy rhythm, from now on we'll. I counted up and realized it's 20 years today since she's been gone. Sometimes her name comes up. People still laugh. It's wonderful how everyone's so witty. They never heard her sing, but they know enough to laugh. Here's where we have a show. I'm too high hat, you're too low. Crazy rhythm, here's goodbye to you. Tickets were like gold. Oh, those days. All the famous smart people. Cole Porter, Noel Coward, Elsa Maxwell, Walter Winchell, the Aga Khan. They all came to hear her. And they say that when a highbrow meets a lowbrow walking along Broadway, soon the highbrow, he has no brow, ain't it a shame, and you're to blame. When you sing, you're like a prize fighter, though you don't use your fists, just air. A thin thread of breath, and that's it. You're mouthing words, making noise, your ears are ringing. Who knows what's coming out? You can never hear what others hear. No two singers are alike. When an artist finds his or her own true voice, second graders sound like everyone else. Oh, the real ones, you hear them. There's no mistaking. They say that when a high brow meets a low brow, people used to say to me, why does she do it? I always thought the better question was, why did I? Everyone has his arrival story, how it was when he first hit New York. Imagine, I'm 24. Oh, do that for me. 1927. New kid on the block, ready to tear up the sidewalk. Friends and I, but no one felt poor. We were young, on the brink, about to do great things. Yeah, meantime, we did this and that to get by. Back then, when singers retired, they taught boys. Madam this and maestro that. The old Hotel Ansonia crowd. I played for their lessons. Meanwhile, I did this and that to get by. At night, I would rehearse my solo recitals, though I never gave any. And I wrote songs. We tried to get them sung. Art songs. We did that then. So let me tell you, after 5 years of living this life, I was pretty damn tired. Her nephew, Gil, was someone I knew from around. He said his aunt had a unique kind of sound. He said she needed someone to play. She had a suite at the Ritz-Carlton on the 16th floor. I went there the next day. She gave me a glass of sweet sherry and showed me to her music room.
Mr. McMoon,
she said,
what matters most is the music you hear in your head. Don't you agree? The impossible ideal, as it were. The beauty, not quite within our grasp. I have always had a great love of music. It's the music that draws me. It's the music that must come before all else. Let me be frank. While singing for friends, I have allowed myself to be accompanied by those who could not always give the music its due, without wishing to give offense, for this my first public recital, I must be ruthless. I seek no reward from my singing, certainly no financial reward, no personal réclame. I assure you this is no mere act of vanity.
Mrs. Foster,
please, yes. Let me finish. I know how it might seem. A woman like myself comes to a man like you, from out of nowhere, declaring herself ready to scale the very pinnacles of the soprano repertoire. You could think me no more than a mere dilettante.
Mrs. Foster,
no, please, you must let me finish. I've sung many times for charity in various drawing rooms. Friends have been kind enough to compliment me on the depth of my feeling. Which is why it has now been proposed that my name on a handbill might prove an attraction. Among my own circle, you understand. I don't speak of the public at large, but still enough to fill a modest hall, which is rather exciting, don't you think? What I seek, have sought, am seeking, is a colleague, a collaborator, a soulmate.
Mrs. Foster,
no, please, you must let me finish. Let me say it once. I would not ask you to undertake such a task without a remuneration that I intend to be fully commensurate with your dignity. Now, what do you say?
It's by no means impossible, what you ask.
I thank you for that. You have given me hope.
It's a matter of polishing, you say.
And perfecting, refining. May I confide in you, Mr. McMoon? You won't think me foolish. Some weeks ago, I dreamed I was singing in public.
Yes?
Do you know what it was that I sang in my dream? The famous aria of the Queen of the Night. Der Rache kocht in meinem Herzen. Tot und verzweifelt mich her. The very words produce chills. You are familiar with that particular aria?
Die Zauberflöte.
Come on.
Magic flute.
Exactly. And do you know who was in the audience, smiling up at me, encouraging me? Mr. Mozart.
Mr.
Mozart. I would hardly call myself a follower of Mr. Freud, but the meaning seemed all too apparent. Did I have it in my voice, I wondered. Few sopranos are equipped to tackle the Queen of the Night. As you're no doubt aware, the aria's range is extensive. I had my doubts. One is only human, after all. However, and this is almost too uncanny. The very next day, Mr. McMoon, while riding in a taxicab on Lexington, I found myself in a slight collision. The F above C burst forth from me spontaneously.
The F above C.
Passers-by were enraptured, amazed. I stepped from the wreckage, a new woman. But enough talk. Let's take the plunge. Shall we make music? Shall we see how we suit? S'il vous plaît. La fanciulla? Perhaps not before lunch. Cosy, so grateful to the voice. Lucia? Ah, she presents a fascinating problem, does she not? How to sing in Italian while at the same time suggesting a Scottish burr. Please, should I mention some special favorite? Shout it out. Faust, Bohème, Rosenkavalier, each delicious in its way. Ah, dear Rigoletto, caro nome. Perfect. You are acquainted, I assume, with the work of Mr. Verdi. modern music isn't to everyone's taste, I know. Mr. McMoon, à votre plaisir.
Are not perhaps quite what is written.
No.
You don't hear it.
I only hear the music.
Listen. Ya da 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 da.
Ya da 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 da.
Ya da 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 da.
By the way, I wonder if you ever considered developing it, or do you find yourself content merely playing piano? But then I have a temperament. Where were we, Cher? Maestro. You must forgive me if I get carried away and obfuscate the tempi, but this is exactly what I hope you'll stop me doing. I put myself entirely in your hands.
Well, sure, okay.
I want you to be harsh, Mr. McMoon.
Harsh? How could I say?
You must be brutally honest.
It seems to me that some notes are not perhaps quite secure.
Secure?
Not quite.
Have you perfect pitch, Mr. McMoon?
Pitch?
Pitch.
I have relative pitches.
Oh, never fear. It's no disgrace, though it must be inconvenient.
You
perfect pitch, yes. You find that hard to believe.
Oh, no.
I wouldn't blame you if you did. There are not many of us who are so blessed.
You spoke of a recital, Mrs. Foster Jenkins, that you're preparing for a recital. I'm wondering exactly what it is you mean by that.
Well, a recital. You would play. I would sing. Song.
Yes, and the scale of it.
Oh, I see. A modest affair, a few select friends, some 200 or so. Certainly no more than 3 or 4. Here at the Ritz in the ballroom to benefit some of my favorite charities.
So this is not something that the general public...
If some music lover should wish to attend, I would certainly hope they could be seated.
Still, this is not something you expect to be, reviewed.
You mean those dreadful newspaper people? Would they be welcome? On no account, no. If you hunger to see your name in print, Mr. McMoon, you'll be disappointed, I'm afraid. If it's ambition.
And that's where I had a choice. Right then. I could have made some excuse, walked out in the afternoon, and gone about my business. But she was so absolutely, transparently sure of herself. Well, not in a vain way. No, she was right about that. She believed the way a child might believe. It was touching somehow. And it seemed to me it would be intolerable if I didn't try to protect her. So was that her vanity or mine? Shall we go on?
Bravo!
Each note has its own value, Mrs. Foster Jenkins. When we see a B-flat on the page, for example, we must be sure that that is the note we sing. It is an absolute, not something about which we can be evasive.
I think it's possible to be too analytical, don't you? Nothing is more detrimental to good singing than this modern mania for accuracy. That was never true in the past. Music came from the heart. You say the notes are absolute, but what are they, after all? Signposts left by the composer to guide us. A vocal artist must claim some latitude.
Mrs. Foster Jenkins.
Yes.
I think it's best to enter into any new relationship with a clear head, don't you? I wouldn't want to make a commitment now, only to disappoint you later.
You have other engagements that would take up your time, or plans, perhaps, to travel?
I'm afraid my bank account doesn't permit me much in the way of trips right now.
I'm glad you're speaking frankly, Mr. McMoon. Let me do the same. I was not always as you see me. Before my father's death, I found myself compelled to make my own way in the world. When confronted with the necessity to choose between art and personal comfort, I left my childhood home and supported myself, laboring many long hours over the keyboard to teach what I could of the great mystery and joy that is music to the children of Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. Believe me, I'm very conscious of the extreme privilege my income provides. One of the sweetest uses of my present relative affluence is making what I have available to others.
This recital, which is not to be reviewed. Gil mentioned a date
6 weeks from today, exactly.
One recital, just one. What harm could it do? Maybe it wasn't exactly what I'd hoped for. But was it my fault that I had the whole of that month's rent to pay since my latest roommate moved out somewhat abruptly over a dispute over the meaning of monogamy? I was already 29. You can't be promising indefinitely.
I'm not sure why you think I can do so much for you, Mrs. Foster Jenkins. You've hardly heard me play. Perhaps my style wouldn't be suitable to show you to your best advantage. Your particular voice, you see, your voice, Mrs. Foster Jenkins.
Mine is not a large voice, Mr. McMoon. What I have is something much more rare. The true coloratura. I don't flatter myself. My own particular gift is purity of tone. Though this might be hard for you to believe, when I was a young woman, my singing was actively discouraged. I have known doubt, the dark night of the soul. Music saved me. Dear me, my hands are trembling. You must not think me precipitate, Mr. McMoon, but somehow I feel my whole life has been a preparation for this meeting. There is a vibration between us, artistically speaking. I cannot help but feel that our partnership is somehow fated.
I thought of my friends, what they'd have to say, of walking out on the platform with her, of sitting at the piano, lifting my hands to play. I thought of the rent. Shall we try picking it up from...
Stop, you must stop.
Pardon me?
This is wrong, if you please.
Oh, I'm sorry, I...
A time like this calls for sacred music. Here. This is the music I would sing with you. Years ago, it was the piece that awoke my soul, the Ave Maria. Oh. Mr. Gounod's, of course. I leave Mr. Schubert's to the mezzo. I should mention, this has always been my final encore. I find my audience has come to expect it. Often, it provokes tears. Beginning, please, at bar 22, the Sancta. Let us start with what is best, Mr. McMoon. For only good can follow.
Oh,
That was how we began our association. We were together 12 years. So we met what? Over 30 years ago. Jesus! Ancient history. I'm a relic and she's a myth. The crazy lady who couldn't sing. We spent many hours rehearsing. Many, many hours. When the great day came, she sang a total of 24 songs and 5 encores. Now, despite all the false starts and the dropped notes, one selection followed another till at last we were done, and she was taking her bows. I snuck back up to the music room. My job was done. I figured I'd change it for the bow.
Dear heart, there you are. Come and meet my friends, please, please, please. They were all overawed by your playing. Finally, to find an accompanist on one's own level. It has been a gift. Now, we must really get to work.
What?
There's so much to be done.
You're not going to do this again.
It seems a large part of the audience simply begged for our return. People had tears in their eyes. Not surprised. I myself saw some literally stop their mouths with handkerchiefs. To stifle their sobs, I assume. Naturally, I will insist that nothing be done without you. We must get to work toot sweet tomorrow.
You mean do this again?
Yes, of course.
Well, the rehearsing and so on? Oh, I'm really very sorry, but I don't think I can. I don't.
You don't?
Unfortunately, there are other claims on my time, other demands, other commitments. Other.
I think I see what's going on.
You do?
How could I not?
I'm sorry. I did my best. I really, naughty boy.
Pardon
me?
I won't allow this.
You won't?
In the 6 weeks I've known you, I've come to care about you, dear heart. About your future as a friend.
See, it's my future. Everybody keeps telling me I need to concentrate more on my own. What am I saying?
This is worse than I thought. For years, I allowed my fears, the opinions of others, to stand in the way of my musical progression. My greatest fear was that I should look somehow ridiculous. Can you imagine? Those who should have been my support sensed my fear and used it to silence my voice. It was only after much internal struggle I was able to break free. Now, here you are, caught in that self-same trap. Others might stand idly by, but I'm not one to watch you throw away such an opportunity. Cosme, if I may call you that.
Oh, I'm grateful, of course.
If you turn your back now, you will simply break my heart. I won't be unreasonable. No. We'll rehearse when you want. At most, a few hours a day. Here, in the music room. I think it's pleasant enough. And you will write your music. Surely, you won't refuse an association that could be of such benefit to us both. Surely you won't do that.
Well, I guess we could give it a shot.
Bravo! Bravissimo! You'll see how well we shall do together. An ongoing, working
partnership.
In the musical sense, not, of course, in the public sense. Now, you must come next door as soon as you're changed. Everyone's dying to meet you.
It was like magic. Word just spread. Every time she sang, more people wanted to hear. You couldn't keep them away. As word got around, her audience changed.
It wasn't just her Park Avenue friends anymore. It was more like the crowd you would see at the fights. We were at the Ritz-Carlton, so there was a certain level of restraint. Even so, I would see them crying when she sang. Doubled over in their seats. Hitting each other convulsed. There would be sudden gasps and shrieks, and they would jump to their feet and run up the aisles. You'd hear doors banging and the sound from the lobby of people laughing. When they got themselves back under control, they would make their way back down the aisle, flushed, still wiping tears away. You see a lot from a piano bench. Meanwhile, Madame Flo was lost in the music. So far as she was concerned, the people running for the doors were too moved to stay. It's too overcome with emotion. At the end, there were bravos and flowers, and afterwards she would serve sherry, and all her friends would talk about what she wore. So one way or another, everyone had a pretty good time. Though I worried. In case a day might come with the balance tipped. When her friends were outnumbered by that other, crueler part of the audience. When those coming to laugh set the tone. We were rehearsing. She loved to rehearse. She rehearsed more than anyone I ever knew. We were preparing for that year's recital. And she was late. Which wasn't like her. Wasn't like her at all. Nothing you'd like.
You mean a popular song?
The kind of thing people dance to, a song.
It has words, this song?
Pardon me?
Words.
Oh, shall we get on?
All in good time.
What? What is it?
Well, just what?
Well, you've got a look about you.
I can't think what you mean.
Yeah, like the cat that got the cream.
Cream, indeed.
Has something happened?
What would they be, these words?
You're not telling me?
For example...
Okay. Crazy Rhythm, here's the doorway.
Oh, please do play, won't you? You were playing so nicely before I came in.
It's really nothing fun. Okay.
Crazy Rhythm, here's a doorway. Ha! I'll go my way, you'll go your way.
I'll go my way, you'll go your way.
No. That's what the beat is. You don't sing that. He's, okay.
They say that, when I got me to low brow, walking along Broadway.
Walking along Broadway.
Walking, it's... Walk in along Broadway.
Walk in along Broadway. Oh, I see. Quite a cheeky little tune, Nespa.
Well, all the accents are falling on the offbeats. It's good. There's a spring to it.
It's the use of prohibition.
Is this what they call jazz? Is it? Goodness, Cosme. Quite shocked the Bechstein.
Music is music.
And people sing this song and they dance. Is that what happens? You and your friends, for example, when you and Kurt, such a personable young man, when you and he are out entertaining the young ladies, you bad boys.
Should we get to work?
I could almost picture myself singing it. I imagine it would create quite a sensation.
Here's the Ritz? Oh, I don't know. Your audience expects something different.
Ah, but what if we were to find ourselves with a different kind of audience?
Different?
Different.
In what way?
Suppose we suddenly found ourselves with more seats to sell.
More seats?
Many more.
But you, Madam Jenny, you've been sold out for weeks.
True.
So why would you need more seats?
so that many more music lovers could pay their $240 to attend.
You've already got $500 coming. Isn't that enough?
Think of my charities, Cosme. Think what such a box office boost could mean.
Boost?
Boost. You see, it's been proposed, quite out of the blue, that we move our recital to a larger venue, which is rather exciting, don't you think?
But I thought you were happy here at the Ritz.
Up to a point.
I thought you liked the intimacy of the ballroom.
Yes and no.
Well, what exactly are we talking? How much larger?
Believe me, we will make quite a splash. There's considerable anticipation among those in the know.
And you've already, I mean, it's all arranged, you just
it's
like...
It's come as a shock, I quite understand.
Yeah, well, I should say so.
I was telephoned, Cosme, and this was proposed.
What was proposed? Move us where? The Hippodrome?
Not... quite.
Where? Dear God, tell me where.
Town Hall.
Town Hall?
It's been proposed we move our concert there, Cosme, where they have guaranteed there will not be a single empty seat. Not one!
But
of course, I knew I had a following. I'm not blind, after all. But I must say, I had no idea I was quite so... popular.
I can't believe what you're telling me.
I can hardly believe it myself.
I mean, what have I been doing all this time? All this rehearsing? This isn't easy for me. I'm trying to do what's right for you. I could just let you sing, you know, but I don't. Because I worry. And because I do the decent thing, everyone assumes that I'll just go along with whatever crazy...
Shh, Cosme. Dear Cosme, think what's at stake. In these perilous times, with so many in need, how can I refuse? We must all try to do some good in the world.
But at what price?
I beg your pardon?
At what price?
I don't understand.
Well, your artistic standards, what of them?
Come dice?
Your voice in a barn like Town Hall.
Barn?
Oh, they didn't tell you? About the acoustics? Well, it's famous for how you can't hear.
You can't?
You'd think you'd gone deaf.
Deaf?
To go from our little room to that great, huge monster is something that should be approached very gradually. Very, very gradually. Well, if at all.
But surely we can rehearse, prepare.
That is strange to be induced. What then?
Strain?
It would undermine everything we've worked for. I cannot allow this. I won't. I don't care what they say.
Strain?
Mrs. Foster Jenkins, listen. If your concern is for extra revenue, wouldn't the same thing be achieved by adding another recital here at the Ritz? At least that way there won't be any...
strain. What can I say? You have saved me from myself.
Well.
Mille grazie, signor buon fortuna.
Prego, I guess.
To abuse my voice is unthinkable. After all, one is not a trombone.
Exactly.
We shall add two more recitals to our present schedule.
Two?
Very well, then three, but no more. How right you are, Cosme, and how very wise. There is no reason to move. There is every reason to stay. I shall explain to Town Hall. Let them find someone else to sing in their barn. Some mezzo or other. Forgive me for not consulting you first. It shall not happen again. Strain.
How could she not know? How? She had to hear the laughter, didn't she?
Well, if people assumed I was in on the joke, that I knew that they knew, maybe they figured she knew too. Well, you know what it's like in this town. There was a lot of speculation over martinis. It was all too sophisticated for words. Hell, I didn't care. Let them think what they like. I kept telling myself this was only part of my life, a means to an end. The money I made working with her kept me going all year. I had a patron. I never saw her in spring or summer. Never saw her outside the music. I had all this free time. Time to do, something remarkable, astonishing. Time to become whoever it was I was supposed to be. So I wrote songs, all kinds of songs. Happy songs, sad songs, short songs, long songs. Songs no one wanted to sing. We had our niche at the Ritz-Carlton. It wasn't exactly ideal, but it was okay. I figured if I couldn't stop her making a fool of herself, at least I could limit the damage. From day one, she begged me to let her sing The Queen of the Night. It was her one big ambition, her one big dream. Don't ask me why. I said, not yet. You're not ready. I'm not ready.
Nobody's ready. How could she think she could sing it? How was it possible? She had no voice, no ear, no musicianship, nothing. Beyond a certain feeling. True, that never stopped her before. Or me either. But the Queen of the Night was like crossing a line. Going from an oddly endearing blind spot, an eccentric lack of perspective, to what? Madness?
I've been invited to make a record. Me. It seems they think I could do much to popularize good music.
I don't understand, Madam J. Who's inviting you to make a record?
The record company.
Yes, but which one?
There's more than one. Well, I should think this must be the record company that appeals to lovers of good music. They want me to choose which particular aria would show off my voice to its best advantage. At last, I shall have a chance to really hear myself.
Oh my God.
The time has finally come to perfect dear Mr. Mozart's beloved aria for the Queen of the Night.
Do you really think that's the best choice for your record?
It is the perfect choice. Think, Cosme, think. In days to come, when my voice is not perhaps quite so strong as it is now, to be able to hear it as it once was, in all its glory, a lovely souvenir.
But think, Madam J, a record can be so misleading.
You're not going to be stubborn, are you? It would mean so much to me. Please, please, please.
What if you were to be disappointed?
Disappointed? In what way?
Well, the sound in your head, what you hear when you sing, could that ever be caught on record?
Cosme, I'm not a fool. You talk to me as if I'm a fool. Dear heart, of course I know that. How could I not? Of course I know it will be but a shadow. Why not at least record what can be recorded? I will imagine the rest. Think of all I could learn. The microphone will be quite objective.
It will not be objective. It will diminish. I am objective. I am your ears.
Dear Cosme, so that's it. You think I would rely on you less? How could that be, when this device will merely allow me to enjoy something of what everyone else hears? Is that such a bad thing?
Suppose that what you hear is not what you expect. Suppose there are aspects of your voice that are not... Sometimes what we hear inside with our inner ear, that is the truth.
You have touched me, Cosme. Truly touched me. I had no idea you had such feelings of protection towards me. But you must see that you can protect too much. It is from our greatest challenges that we learn most. Without the risk of failure, there can be no success. You say the microphone will diminish, so will doubt. Art cannot be ruled by caution. The queen of the night awaits. My breath is her life. We have come this far together. Let's not falter now.
A record. Hear herself? The queen of the night?
Oh. Yes. My one reservation is that there is a place, you know, where it's, and I'm not sure, but I think something goes awry. I'm surprised you didn't notice yourself. I'm surprised you didn't notice yourself, you bad boy, because really, if there is an imperfection, no matter how small, we must be allowed to correct it before it's sent for sale. Record that side over. Cosme, do you intend to say nothing?
Oh, I'm thinking. It's a lot to take in.
My friends will all want copies. So will yours.
Oh, my God.
I'm told it will be available at Altman's, among other places. So it's quite important that everything be perfect. You know how critical people can be. To say nothing of the newspapers. I've kept them away from our recitals, but I can do nothing to stop them availing themselves of a record. I've seen how unpleasant they can be when they have the opportunity to criticize a person above their social sphere. Goodness knows I'm no snob. Look how well you and I get on. But you can't expect some gutter journalist to have an appreciation for or knowledge of the music of Mr. Mozart. Let me try to find. There, you heard it. I'm certain of it now. Something is not quite right. No doubt, in a recital, such a teeny tiny flaw would not be remarked on. The presence of the artist would bring the hearers along. But that microphone is so unforgiving, so unaware of nuance. I see that now. Not that I didn't believe you when you warned me, but still, it's all rather humbling. But there can be no doubt, the piano is not quite with the voice. No doubt you are unnerved to find yourself away from our dear music room. Your concentration was not all it should have been. You must not blame yourself, not for one moment.
There's a mistake? You want it to be right?
Naturally. I mean, don't you?
Don't I? Oh, don't I?
Cosme, what is the matter?
You want it to be right? Well, let's just get it right then, shall we? Let's just get it right, okay? Da, 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 da. Do it. No. Do it. No. Do it. No. Do it. No.
Cosme, you must not punish yourself further.
Don't you hear? Why don't you listen? Da, 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 da. Why don't you listen? For God's sakes, what's wrong with you? Da, 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 da. God damn it, just sing what's on the page, you silly woman!
You said I should be brutal, right at the first.
I did not ask you to be rude.
I want you to sing as well as you can. I would hope you believe me when I say that. Because I mean it, sincerely.
I am not a silly woman.
Perhaps I spoke too abruptly.
You have some sense of shame.
Yes.
There is nothing wrong with my ear. Nothing at all.
No.
Nothing. I want that clearly understood.
Yes.
I am known for my ear.
Yes.
Nothing. Nothing. Nothing.
Every Greek, each Turk, and each Latin, each Russian and Prussian as well, when they seek the lure of Manhattan, are sure to fall under your spell.
Nothing.
Their native folk songs they soon throw away. Those Harlem smoke songs they soon learn to play. Can't you fall for Carnegie Hall? Madam. Call it a day and we'll say. Crazy rhythm, here's the doorway. I'll go my way. You'll go your way. Crazy rhythm, here's goodbye to you. Here's where we have a lowdown. You're too hi-hat. I'm too low down. Crazy rhythm, here's goodbye to you. They say that when a highbrow meets a lowbrow, walking along Broadway, soon the highbrow, she has no brow. Ain't it a shame? And I'm to blame.
You bad boy.
What's the use of prohibition?
Ridiculous song.
Crazy rhythm got me going. Crazy rhythm, there's a knowing. Crazy rhythm, why I'm here with you.
Those are not the words, Cosme. For goodness sake, you might at least sing the right words. They say that when a highbrow meets a lowbrow, walking, walking, walking along Broadway, aren't you going to play? Do it.
Soon the highbrow, she has no brow.
Ain't it a shame, and you're to blame. What's the use of prohibition?
You produce the same condition.
I'm going crazy. silly.
We'll do it for your next album.
So... you must know, dear heart, how very grateful I am for all that you do. So very grateful. So very, very grateful.
My friends all bought the album record.
Thank you.